Hello there, and welcome to another episode of the Replay Roundup series. I'm being joined by Ixta today, and we do have a replay of the tank that you can see in between the both of us. It is the Rheinmetall Kampfpanzer 07RH.
He's just flexing the fact that he's German, and I can't say that, but it's the KPZ07RH for the rest of us by one of the NA players, so let's head straight into the replay and get started, shall we?
Yep, let's go into the game we go, and we do see he is spawned on El Haluf. Ammunition loadout 30, 30, 20, and especially I like the 20 HE that he immediately starts preloading here, because the KPZ, it does have very good HE pen. It also gets a crazy DPM increase when he uses those. And yeah, the other ammos are not too bad either, but really the HE on this DPM machine is what does stand out. Other than that, yeah, medkit, rep kit, and some sweet chocolate to go. And immediately a Lynx gets spotted.
Oh, this could be interesting with HE loaded, but unfortunately his tank dips down as he clips the corner there. But the second shot doesn't miss as he pens that one for 327, and he tries to get a third, but he doesn't quite get it. Maybe the LT wants some heat? Nope, maybe not. But yeah, the HE on the Kampfpanzer 07RH, a very potent shell, and by far one of my favorite tanks to fire HE in. While it's not a high caliber derp gun that's going to take off all your HP instantly, the fact that it has about a 3 to 4 second reload with like a really high penetration for HE shells at this caliber and at this tier,
can be absolutely...
It's really, really brutal. And we might see... he switched back to AP because he knows he's going to be firing on the sides of tanks that are crossing, and he manages to get a perfect penetration into that Centurion 1. Unfortunately, it wasn't quite a tracking shot, so the Centurion manages to cross for free.
Exactly. I mean, with that low of a caliber of a gun, you can't even be sure to take off the enemy tracks, even if you shoot directly through the track wheel. You just don't have the module damage for it, but you more than make up for it in the DPM department. And his allied Renegade is now pushing forward. He decides that is not for him. Meanwhile, he tries to get a snipe into the Lynx, but vastly overestimating his own shell velocity here. But the Udes 14-5 is able to pick up the Lynx, so that is one of the pesky spotters in the enemy team gone. Still, the LT-432 remains, and yeah, the Lynx is trying to make his way here right now. So I like what Achu, bless you by the way, is doing. He's yeah, just trying to give support to the Lynx, extend his support here, but realizes there are not going to be any spots anytime soon, so he does make his way up again. He doesn't really want to go frontally brawl with all of those tanks, because against all of them in frontal brawls he would lose, so I respect his decision to not overcommit.
I think the big issue here is a lot of his allies have pushed into this dip here and across without really checking what's further back in these areas. And what that means is now they're getting pincered from several different directions here where they need to be extremely careful. So he's come back to try and support to make sure they don't all fall apart. Now, of course, we do see the T26E4 in the corner there surviving and winning against the Centurion. As soon as he takes him out, he'll be able to put a bit of pressure on the Caliban and T103. We'll see how much. But now he overpeaks, puts a shot into the IS-5, which... I've got to be honest, tank that you don't see that often. And the IS-5 does go down for that slight moment of greediness over peeking on these guys. And now he's going to try and get this Udes to back off. But Udes does it without needing to take a shot for it. Now it looks like he's going to go in to try and help his teammates out. And it's probably going to be a push over the top is what I'd expect, straight over this way. But it looks like he's actually holding the side here as a T103 tries to cross. We can't quite get the gun depression. And now it's just a matter of trying to find the shots without losing too much HP here, because he is technically stuck. Yeah, very nice shot there. He is technically in a position where he could take shots from the Caliban if the Caliban decides to get greedy and come straight around that corner, but he manages to shut down the Pershing with well-aimed shots and with the insane rate of fire this tank has. And now he's doing the right play of playing on the right side of this opening and aiming behind him to support the Pershing against the T103, meaning the Caliban can't shoot him. Now, if he peeked on this side at B2, closer towards A2, A1, then he would have possibly taken damage from the Caliban if he's still on that corner.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So, good situational awareness there.
Right now, game is looking good, right? 6-5 in the kill department for his team. He's still on 1,060 HP, so very, very healthy. And yeah, they are slightly behind according to the tracker. But yeah, the Udes equalizes the score now, and our hero here smartly does not decide to overcommit because he doesn't have any info on the Rheinmetall. He does, yeah, the RT just punishes the Progetto for this one. He doesn't have any info on the SCRV, and I like what he does now. HE preloaded and looking for that position where the Rheinmetall is very likely to be, and that shell disappeared.
And that one didn't, meaning the first one probably hit the Rheinmetall or another tank, and then they decided to back off. Now, of course, the big thing about pushing down from this way is you don't know what tanks are here. There's a Rheinmetall, and it looks like he did hit that shot, and that could be a chunky amount of HP that he managed to pick up there. But as I was saying, you do need to be mindful of this position here where the Udeses are, as they can crossfire this position as you push down. Fortunately for our protagonist here, they weren't quite looking in his direction, as they were more interested in the approach of the allies coming from A5, A6, and that has allowed him to sneak up, get closer, and now it's a matter of finding out where the angles are.
Caliban
and
just connected,
look what he's found.
HE shell into the Udes, and yeah, nice shot into the RT here, and luckily that one connects as well, so one of the prime threats taken out of the game here. But yeah, guess who's still unspotted? It's the SCRV. And where is that tank most likely to sit? Well, in a situation like this, A0 is a pretty good guess. So he does right to not overcommit onto the Udes tanks.
Indeed. I'm going to predict he's somewhere more like around E0 sort of area on these ridges, but we'll have to find out in a moment. But again, our protagonist here making good situational awareness, good situational decision making. He realizes there's tanks in the low side here still alive, so he decides to rotate around the bottom here to get shots on them to secure that area, because it means his Scorpion G teammates a bit safer, his T28 prototype teammates a bit safer, the Progetto's a bit safer, and it means the enemies can't come around behind him and start farming him up the rear. And now he has found the LT-432. Unfortunately, HE is not quite going to pen at that angle, and I think he realized that because he did click the one key to preload AP for his next shell, and he has switched completely off now, as he's going to look to support the Udes, who is getting pushed by the Caliban.
The Caliban, obviously huge alpha, and does connect that shot here, taking out the Udes, and now that situation that looked ever so good, well, they drove
not
into...
Not looking so good anymore.
Yeah, they drove into crossfire after crossfire. Ooh. HE penetration and the fire to go with it. That one does not penetrate, however. So the Udes gets to live for now.
I think the second HE shell there hit the track a bit more, hit a bit of spaced armor, as opposed to hitting the broadside where it's more just flat armor. So unfortunately, no reignition of fire there. Unfortunately, no penetration there. And now, again, he's making good situational awareness. Instead of getting peeked from several different angles, he's relocated to a position where he can't get peeked from as many. From his previous position here, he could have been peeked from this area, from this area, from this area, or even from this area. If any tanks get greedy, they can move all the way around. So instead, he's decided to move around in the other direction so that he's a bit safer, and also now putting some distance between himself and the enemies, which honestly, in this situation, is exactly what you need to do. Get that Scorpion's gun into play as well by pulling the enemies into his line of fire.
Now, he doesn't want to give all of the space up yet. And yeah, that shell does not connect here. But the T28 prot overstayed his welcome. He tried to support his team. He tried to move forward, but he pays the ultimate price because before he was able to help, all of his teammates had already died. And I personally did not know of this bush here. Up until basically this moment that I saw this replay the first time. So I like what he's doing. He's trying to get his Scorpion into the game. It is still 4k HP on the enemy team. And yeah, the Rheinmetall does get spotted here. He's hoping for the Scorpion to connect the shot, and the Scorpion does. So good stuff happening here, because the Rheinmetall is now an HE one shot, but the LT-432 is flanking around here, and the M40 actually finishes off the Rheinmetall.
Indeed. Now that's huge, because what it means is, as long as the Udeses haven't moved around into these similar positions here to try and snipe, it means that our protagonist can now potentially safely climb back up if he wanted to go support the artillery and the Scorpion G without having to worry about the Borsig peeking and shooting him in the rear with the large caliber gun, potentially taking off a lot of the 1060 HP he has left. And that's exactly what he's going to do. He's going to start heading back to try and support against the LT-432, the Caliban, the Udes, whoever's trying to come up from that side. Keep in mind, one tank's still unspotted, the Sturv S1, and he's got two kills, so we'll have to wait and see where he is.
I mean, keep in mind, if there's tanks that can remove a lot of HP very quickly, the Caliban certainly is amongst them. I think even with two AP shells, the Caliban should be able to completely eliminate The Rheinmetall here on 1060, and now the LT-432 does get spotted. Good first shot into the LT, and a nice follow-up as well here, bringing him down to like 400 HP, so that's a possible two-shot. It's a start.
Indeed, it's a start. I don't know how I feel about him stopping to aim at the LT in that position, though, earlier. That's asking the Caliban to hit a shot on the rear of his tank or on the broadside, but he manages to get away with it for now. Which indicates perhaps the Caliban just wasn't pre-aimed, maybe he's not even in position yet, but this LT is definitely overcommitting right now and needs to go down, because right now he's pinning all three of our friendly tanks in position right now. The Scorpion and M40 can't really move without being seen by the LT now. So we'll see what magic needs to happen here to deal with the LT and to continue clawing back from this, and we'll see if they claw back from this. But right now, I suspect the Sturv is moving into position somewhere along these ridge lines to get better shots, and the Udezes will be moving in. We see the LT has tried to escape. Scorpion G spots him, and we'll see how this engagement goes down as our protagonist looks to get a supporting line of fire, and he does find it. Unfortunately, Scorpion goes down to one of the Udezes, but that's a dead LT, and we take that there, I think.
Yeah, I guess you gotta count your wins in situations like this. Now it's... yeah, basically 2v4, but the RT is already down to a one-shot, and the problem is starting to become obvious to me is that he can't really poke out of this position too much, because every time he does it, he risks basically receiving one or even two by the Caliban. Now, the M40 is currently going back. Now, good intuition use here, because, well, basically frontally with AP, you can't really pen the SJB because of the out-of-bounds angle, but... yeah, with heat, you definitely can. Does get two into the SJB as one for taking one in return. So now down to 613, and I believe that might have been one of the shots.
That'll
from
be
the Caliban,
yeah. Indeed. The Caliban did pick up the artillery, giving away the fact that it's somewhere in this northern region here, and that second shell confirms it. And now he's just going to have to relocate a tiny bit and find a better angle. And our protagonist manages to find the Udez. And knowing the Caliban's on reload means you can safely sort of peek this. But unfortunately, shot doesn't connect. Sturv coming over the top is going to go for the drive wheel track shot, which is perfect. That's exactly what you need right now. He's going to go for it again, knowing the Sturv has used his repair kit, but it looks like he has two repair kits. Interesting decision. Sturv goes for the ram, which isn't what you want to do here if you're in the Sturv, because now it means the KPZ, which has really good mobility, is going to be able to circle you for free, and that's exactly what he does. Spotless gameplay right there, taking out the Sturv, and next up it's going to be the Udez on the chopping block, the one shot tank that comes in too close, goes down, and now the next Udez, who is a lot more healthier, and that shot missing isn't the greatest scenario, but
another shot missed here by the Udez, and the brutal DPM that is the trademark of the Kampfpanzer is just coming into effect here. One by one by one, they just line up to get all slaughtered. But here is the final enemy, the Caliban. A nice tracking shot, but the Caliban does have a rep kit available. So he tries to track him once again. The Caliban missing one of his two shots here. And he does make into safety. That was the second shot. The Caliban just gone. Completely giving away the game here. And you can see the Caliban... our hero here with a salute in disguise, and the Caliban, he is just all out. He has 30 seconds reload, so from the realms of impossibility, you can see him shooting a salute into the air. He probably can't believe what just happened, but yeah, our hero in the Kampfpanzer, Ashu, by the Clown Relic, is able to lock down the victory for his team, and what an ending.
Indeed, and let's take a look at the endgame stats there, shall we? That's a mastery badge, of course. That's a bruiser, a duelist, a fire for effect, a high caliber, and a top gun. Mr. Keyhand, would you like to go over how much XP he got and how much damage he got at the end of that?
Yep, so that was 2,043 base XP, 7 kills to his name, over 7k damage. And if we take a look at the credit department... well, he's going to be happy because he made over 100k in profit, and he also had a lot of fun in the process, don't you think so?
I think fun is one way of putting it. There's definitely a lot of moments where I'd be pulling my hair out, to be fair. You know who wouldn't be happy right now? The enemy Caliban, and I gotta feel sorry for him after missing those two shots there right at the end. But that was a game changer for sure. Unfortunately for him, he didn't quite connect those shots, and the KPZ came out with the win there. Our tanker... Ashu from the Relic Clan over on the NA region, managing to clutch that game. That being said, ladies and gentlemen, we hope you enjoyed this episode of Replay Roundup. Make sure you subscribe and leave a like, hit that notification bell so that you don't miss a future replay roundup video, and we'll see you in the next one. Take care.